Welcome to the Nord Pentecostal Church live stream, a place to be family.
Good morning. It's a wonderful sunny day. It's going to get hotter through the day, so we're going to jump right in and get moving, and we'll get you sweaty and moving with worship as well, so enjoy. Couple of quick announcements. Washrooms are available at the far door over where you see our VBS giving trees. If you need one, they are just one person in at a time. Please pay attention to that. If you would like to help with resource supplies for VBS, the trees are down there. All you need to do is on your way by, grab a slip of paper and then make sure in the next couple weeks that you bring in what is listed on that paper. You can grab a couple, you can grab 10, whatever you feel like. We just know that these are the supplies we need help with. So if you can help in any way and make sure that all of our supplies come in, that would be wonderful. So again, they're just on the trees down by the entrance for the washrooms. Let's stand together and worship. We're going to open in prayer. Father, I thank you for this wonderful day, this opportunity to come to be in your presence, to understand the depth of your love. Pray as we sing, as we hear your word, as kids go off, as whatever it is today, Lord, that it is your agenda, not ours. So, Lord, we come in worship of you, and we ask you to come and meet with us each. In Jesus' name, amen.
Every day I will bless you.
I will bless you.
Every day I will praise your name. Every day I will bless you forever and ever.
Oh, every day.
Every day I will bless you.
I will bless you.
Every day I will praise your name. Every day I will bless you forever and ever.
Your name is wonderful.
Your name is wonderful. Your name is Counselor. Your name is Mighty God. Everlasting Father. Your name is Prince of Peace. Your name is King of Kings. Your name is Lord of Lords. Your name is Jesus. Every day I will bless you. Every day I will praise your name. Every day I will bless you forever and ever. Your name is beautiful. Your name is marvelous. Your name is merciful. The name of Jesus. Your name is powerful. Your name is glorious. Your name is wonderful. The name of Jesus. Every day I will bless you. Every day I will praise your name. Every day I will bless you forever and ever. And at your name every knee shall bow. At your name every tongue confess that Jesus Christ is Lord in heaven and on earth. At your name every knee shall bow. At your name every tongue confess that Jesus Christ is Lord forever and ever. Every day I will bless you. Every day I will praise your name. Every day I will bless you forever and ever.
Every day I will bless you.
Every day I will bless you. Every day I will praise your name. Every day I will bless you forever and ever.
Every day. You know, it's a choice we make every day. You wake up in the morning, God is with you. God is beside you. How can you not bless his name? Water he turned into wine. Oh, you open the eyes of the blind. There's no one like you. None like you. Into the darkness you shine. And out of the ashes we rise. There's no one like you. None like you. Oh, declare it this morning. Our God is greater. Our God is stronger. God, you are higher than any other. Our God is healer. He's awesome in power. Our God, he's our God.
Our God.
The water you turned into wine. Oh, you opened the eyes of the blind. There's no one like you, none like you. Into the darkness you shine, out of the ashes we rise. There's no one like you, there's none like you. Our God is greater. Our God is stronger. God, you are higher than any other. Our God is healer. He's awesome in power. Our God, our God. And if our God is for us, then who could ever stop us? And if our God is with us, then what could stand against? And if our God is for us, who could ever stop us? If our God is with us, then what could stand against? What could stand against? Our God is greater. Our God is stronger. God, you are higher than any other. Our God is healer. You're awesome in power. Our God, our God. Our God is greater. Our God is stronger. God, you are higher than any other. Our God is healer. He's awesome in power. Our God, our God. Our God is greater. Our God is stronger than anything this world can throw at us. And he loves us so. Into the darkness you shine. The darkness that's in here, let him shine a light on it. It says, my hope is built on nothing less than a God who is greater. My hope is built on nothing less than Jesus' blood and righteousness. I dare not trust the sweetest frame, but wholly trust in Jesus. Oh, sing that again. My hope is built. My hope is built on nothing less than Jesus' blood and righteousness. I dare not trust the sweetest frame, but wholly trust in Jesus' name. It's Christ alone. Christ alone, cornerstone, the weak made strong in the Savior's love. All through the storm, all he is Lord. Lord of all, Lord of all. When darkness seems
to hide his face. I rest on his unchanging grace. In every high and stormy gale, my anchor holds within the veil. My anchor holds within the veil. It's Christ alone, cornerstone, the weak made strong in the Savior's love. Through the storm, he is Lord, he's Lord of all. When he shall come with trumpet sound, oh, may I then in him be found, dressed in his righteousness alone, faultless stand before the throne. It's Christ alone, my cornerstone, the weak made strong in the Savior's love. Through the storm, he is Lord, Lord of all. It's Christ alone, cornerstone, weak made strong in the Savior's love. Through the storm, he is Lord, Lord of all. Christ alone, the weak made strong. Through the storm, you ever been there? Through the storm, the time to bless his name. He is there with us. If you place your hope in anything in this world, around it, it will fail. It will let you down. One of the biggest problems in the world today is hopelessness. Hopelessness, but that hope is found in Jesus Christ. And when you place your hope there, there's a calmness that settles in your spirit. The winds and waves and storms around about, they buffet you. But the hope is based in Christ Jesus. There's a calm that covers me when I kneel down at his feet. It's a place of healing. There's a calm that covers me when I kneel down at your feet. It's a place of healing. It's a place where I find. Oh, sing that again. Let that calm rest in your spirit. There's a calm that covers me when I kneel down at your feet. It's a place of healing. It's a place where I find freedom. There's a place my eyes can see, where my spirit longs to be. It's a place of healing. It's a place I'll live in freedom. I'm gonna lift my hand. I can reach heaven. I'm gonna shout your name till the walls come falling down. I've come to worship. I've come to worship. There's a love that lives in me. There's a love that lives in me. For you, Lord, my Savior King, who breaks the sin that's binding, leads me to a place of freedom. Oh, lift your hands to him this morning. I'm gonna lift my hands till I can reach heaven. I'm gonna shout your name till the walls come falling down. I've come to worship. I've come to worship. I'm gonna sing my songs like I am unashamed. I'm gonna shout for joy at the mention of your name. I've come to worship. I've come to worship. There's no one that can bring me peace, that can wash me clean like you, Lord. There's nothing in this world that can free me. Oh, you saved my soul. I'm gonna lift my hands till I can reach heaven. I'm gonna shout your name till the walls come falling down. I've come to worship. I've come to worship. I'm gonna sing my song like I'm unashamed. I'm gonna shout for joy at the mention of your name. I've come to worship. I've come to worship. There's a calm that covers me when I kneel down at your feet. It's a place of healing. It's a place where I find freedom.
Lord, it is a incredible thought that when we come to your feet, doesn't matter what our day's been like, if we have followed as close as possible, where we have felt like your presence is nearer than it ever has been, or if we have been in a place that we have wandered, where we have purposely walked away for some reason, that when we come and rest at your feet, there is freedom there, that there is love that is given to us, that it's not an area where we come and discipline is heavy and harsh and drives us away, but it brings us closer to your heart. And I thank you that in your presence there is freedom. Lord, as we would move towards your word, the purpose that you've given to shepherds, to pastors, to leaders in your church, God, I pray that you would open our eyes. Start with me, Lord. Show me these things. Teach them to me well. And then to each one, Father, that we would bless you in all that we do. So, Lord, we thank you that you have been here from early this morning, preparing this place for us to meet with you. And you have done that already today. We invite you to remain here, Lord, and to be blessed by what we do. In Jesus' name, amen. You may be seated. Lisa, would you prefer me up on the trailer? Okay. I'm going to stay here then. We're going to dismiss our children, those who are registered, or if you're ready to head on in. Pastor Solomon, I don't know if he's at the door, but he's on the other side. I know that. So if you want to make your way inside where the air conditioning is and you don't risk sunburn, that would be great. And away you go. I'm just going to grab my stuff as they make their way. So we are in this series talking about purposes of things in the Christian life. We've talked about the Bible, we've talked about church, both the building and the people, and now we're going to talk about pastors or leaders within the church, and that's going to take a little bit of time to actually explain how we're approaching this, so I'll do that in a minute. Each one we look at is, they're things that are ordained of God. They're put in place by Him for proper structure within what He has designed. So we're going to discuss the purpose of a pastor. What exactly did God intend when He placed the office of pastor in His list of those who He has called for the purpose of overseeing the church and the ministries He has given us? In preparation of this, I thought it would be interesting to go online to the group of the POC pastors that I belong to and ask them, what in your ideals is the purpose of a pastor? And I gave them very specific instruction. Do not give me scripture quotes. I have a good handle on that. I want what is fresh thought. What's original to you? Where do you see that God has given us this purpose? What is it as a pastor that God has purposed? And time again, every answer started with, Larry, I know you didn't ask for scripture, but, which shouldn't surprise me. It should be a good thing that the first ideal for them is to go to scripture and what God has given as an outline for us. But I asked them, like, can you give me original thought? I'm good with the scripture, but time and time again, it was scripture. So maybe a more telling question would have been, what do your people in your church think the purpose of a pastor is? But I didn't ask because I realized we have this wonderful thing called Google, and you can type that in, what do people think the purpose of a pastor is? And I found some interesting ones. I don't know that any of you feel this way, but this is what Google tells me people feel. So here's what it says. There's five of them. The first one says, he's the preacher who needs to share God's word and help us apply it effectively to our lives, but he better not take too long. I got things to do. Second one is, he's the pastor and he's there to do what I tell him to do. Third one is, the pastor is a messenger of God who was sent here to make me happy. Fourth, the pastor is the teacher. He's the one who sets vision. He leads the people to holiness. He cuts the grass. He cleans the toilets. He teaches Sunday school. He watches the budget. He leads worship. He makes coffee every Sunday. He visits the whole church at least twice a month. He attends every community event. He volunteers for two outside organizations. And she wears a dress every day of the week. That was one explanation. Last one, and this one's my favorite, and it's not for my kids, but it's, the pastor's my dad, and he needs to make me breakfast now. Some of these are expectations. They're not all purpose. Some aren't even anything to do with the role, but the Bible is actually clear that God sent pastors to the local church. Paul speaks on this repeatedly, but we're going to take a look at his words as recorded by Luke in Acts chapter 20. In my Bible, this section is labeled Paul's farewell to the Ephesian church. At this point, he believes he will not come back to Ephesus, that he won't see this church again. We know by reading Paul's works that later on he does come back to the church. But at this moment in Acts 20, he believes that he will not see these people anymore. So we'll see a little bit of that. If you go back a few verses beforehand, you actually see the portion of scripture where Paul is preaching so long that Eutychus falls asleep, tumbles out of the window, and dies. Paul goes down and prays for him, and he comes back to life. And thankfully, the faith of Paul stepped in, because the legacy he would have had was, that man is so boring, people die when he preaches. But we add to it, he also prays for the resurrection, and it actually happens. So we're going to read verses 25 through 31 to give a little bit of the context of where we're going. In chapter 20 of Acts, starting at 25. It says, now I know that none of you among whom I have gone about preaching the kingdom will ever see me again. Therefore, I will declare to you today that I am innocent of the blood of any of you, for I have not hesitated to proclaim to you the whole will of God. And keep watch over yourselves and all the flock of which the Holy Spirit has made you overseers. Be shepherds of the church of God, which he bought with his own blood, or with the blood of his son. I know that after I leave, savage wolves will come in among you and will not spare the flock. Even from your own number, men will arise and distort the truth in order to draw away disciples after them. So be on your guard. Remember that for 3 years I never stopped warning each of you night and day with tears. I want to add a passage from 1 Peter chapter 5 as well, verses 1 to 4. It gives a better context of the biblical purpose of the shepherd. It says, to the elders among you, I appeal as a fellow elder and a witness of Christ's sufferings, who also will share in the glory to be revealed. Be shepherds of God's flock that is under your care, watching over them, not because you must, but because you are willing, as God wants you to be, not pursuing dishonest gain, but eager to serve, not lording it over those entrusted to you, but being examples to the flock. And when the chief shepherd appears, you will receive the crown of glory that will never fade away. Now, I know that I said we're going to take a look at the purpose of the pastor, and that's what we're going to do. That will be included. But in reading these scriptures and others, what I came to an understanding of is that often the way that Paul and others approached churches is that there wasn't always a pastor or a shepherd or a deacon or an elder. There were sometimes groups. And not all churches employ the term pastor. Some say this is our elder who leads us. Some will actually say this is our shepherd. Some use apostle. Some say prophet. So we're going to make an analysis of this and just say it's generalization, the shepherd. And that will apply not just to those who take the form of the teacher in front of the congregation on a Sunday, but it will also apply to any who lead within the church. So if you're leading a Bible study, a small group, if you teach in children's ministry, if you are a worship leader, if you take form of any ministry, you are participating as a shepherd in the church. So as we walk through the message, we're not just looking at pastors, we are looking at them, but more specifically as all who lead as a team. Pastor who leads, for those unfamiliar with the construct that God has given us, specifically in the POC, in our church, and those who are affiliated, the pastor leads the church alongside the board who is elected by the membership. We oversee things answering to the chief shepherd, who is Jesus. The support staff comes around them. Volunteers with each ministry come around the support staff, and the congregation as a whole serves each other as a people, all serving Jesus. All of us who are believers are called to minister, but for the purpose of today's message, we're going to look at those who lead and understand that they take form of shepherd at one point in their life. So we can settle on the fact that the call to shepherd is purposed with leading people, but it is defined, I believe, with five purposes in itself. So I believe that when we consider these five, we will see the context of the shepherd through the lens that God wants us to correctly see it. And in each point, if there are other passages which apply, which often there are, I'll let you know what they are. Some of them may apply more to just the pastoral role. Some will apply to all who lead or serve as a shepherd or under shepherd. They will fit across the whole spectrum. Now, this is not a deep dive into the Bible as to what a pastor is or a shepherd is or a leader is, but it will give you the five main purposes that God has given us. So let's begin. First one is teach the flock. Now, when you read through, if you have a King James or even a New King James in some, when you read through Acts and 1 Peter, it actually uses the term, instead of care for, it says feed the flock. Now, when the King James was written, there was an understanding that the most inherent need across humanity is food. So when they translated the word care for, they used the word feed because that fit the need of all people. But when we look at the proper terminology of care for, it covers a lot of ground. And so all the things that we're going to talk about cover caring for the flock, not just feeding. Also, if we have an understanding, the intention of using the word feed goes back to the conversation of Jesus and Peter when Jesus asks of Peter, do you love me, Peter? If so, feed the sheep. But again, the interpretation is there of care for them. Give yourself to them in service. Be self-sacrificing, because to that point, Peter was selfish. He wanted for himself and not for the sheep around him. And so Jesus is calling him to give of himself and not serve in selfish ambition anymore. So the word feed doesn't accurately fit the description. Also, I understand as a pastor, it is my job to feed myself spiritually. And it is also my role to help give you opportunity to be fed. But it is your role to feed yourself and make sure that spiritually you are developing to where God has called you to. So when we say things like, I don't feel fed in this location, you have to understand that as a leader, I have been trained over 20 years of ministry to look at that and say, one, what can we do better? And two, how is your devotional life at home? Because Sunday is not enough to feed you. Sunday is not enough to develop you. You have every day to wake up and get into the Word, to pray, to sit in the presence of Jesus, to worship, to serve Him and others. That is spiritual food. That is where we develop ourselves. And Paul says at one point, you should have developed to the point where we're feeding you spiritual strength, the heaviness of food, like meat and potatoes, but we're still giving you milk. He's calling us to work it out ourselves. So the word feed doesn't necessarily fit, but teach is where we start when talking about caring for the flock. So it is purposed that the shepherd will teach the church and do so in a way that instructs those they are entrusted with to stay close to Jesus. In 2 Timothy 1:11, it says, in the gospel, which I was appointed as herald and an apostle and a teacher. The word herald there actually means one who carries good news. It applies to all of you. You are a herald of the good news. If you are a believer, you are the one who carries the good news, and you've been entrusted with the purpose to bring that to all people. But greater in this, the words apostle and teacher apply to those who teach. So the pastor as shepherd or as teacher works this through teaching, not just the word of God, but in the way they live their life. Can you imagine if I stood up here and I tried to give you an accurate description of what scripture is telling us, how to apply it to your life, how to live properly under the commands and the teachings of Jesus, but my daily life looked nothing like what I preached? If I came up here and I said, you have to do all that you can to live close to Jesus, to get into his face, to give up yourself to him, to worship him, and yet I never spent any time with him, what would that look like? It would look like complete hypocrisy. And Jesus made clear distinction of what he thought of hypocrites when he dealt with the Pharisees. My role as a teacher is to be an example, not just in the word I teach, but in the character of myself, to reflect that to you, to reflect the character of Jesus to all of those around, to see his love in me and to live it out as well. But when it comes to teaching, it's to be clear that what we share is proper and it is clearly defined as God's word, follows good theology. I was told of a man who had no books of reference in his library. He had no commentaries, no lexicons, no geographical or historical studies. He didn't look to what has existed for hundreds of years to help us properly disseminate what the word says. He just went about saying, I hope I don't lead you astray today. I don't understand it because we have hundreds of years of people doing the work for us to stay on track and not lead us astray. To stand here and say, hopefully I don't lead you astray with this, means we didn't prepare. Means we didn't do the work we've been entrusted with. There are times where the Spirit will move and change our minds in the moment, but when we know something is given to us weeks in advance, we prepare, we get ready. It's the opportunity to present the whole counsel of God and do so with integrity, and the knowledge that comes from mouth or pen will not cause you to stumble, but will give you a great light of hope. Now, I warn you, if there is any here who say, I want to teach, I feel that I am a teacher, I want you to be sure that the anointing and the calling is there, because we are warned in Scripture that in James 3, it highlights that we will give account to every word that we share, and every soul that is under our care, we are accountable for. So if you desire to teach, don't just jump at it and say, okay, I'm going to find a spot and go teach, because everything that you share as a teacher you are accountable to. Secondly, the shepherd leads the flock. Perhaps this should have been first, but it's second on my list. I know there are churches, again, where we don't use the term pastor. They say elder, shepherd, apostle, so on. But Acts makes it clear that these are interchangeable. That as the leader of the church or leaders within the church, you are a shepherd. And so we lead. In the second Peter passage, the pastor is called on to exercise oversight, or the shepherd, over those they are entrusted to their care. This isn't about lording control over a person. I don't believe that at any point, any person should have absolute control over everything that happens within ministries of a local church. I believe that a pastor should have knowledge of what is happening, but shouldn't be at the point where everything works through their hands. That's what people are for. That's why we want volunteers, because we want to release you into the service of ministry that God has called you to. That's that whole point of preparing people for the work of the ministry, to release you, to know that God has empowered you, to be encouraged, and to know that this is where your anointing rests. This is where the skills and the talents God has given you will flow through you. We are to invest in the lives of those around us, to grow the leaders who first follow and then lead, and do so in the same spirit, to grow other leaders to go outward. I was having a conversation with someone a while ago that if somebody comes with an idea for a ministry, my first reaction is generally, when will you start? Let's walk that through. I'm excited that this is your idea. Let's see it actually come to fruition. I don't want to hear an idea and say, okay, so how do I do this? I want to empower you and release you to go. I'm glad to hear that you're excited, and I want to be a part of developing that if possible. But if it's God's vision for your life, that's your call. Let's release you. Let's stand beside you and support you. But that's what a shepherd does. They come alongside and make sure that you are ready to go and to lead what God has called you to, and to develop others to do so as well. As a shepherd, there's an understanding that leading is not about the benefits or acclamation. Much of what is done is actually not noticed. See, a literal shepherd leads his sheep to a location where they can graze in safety, where they are not put in place of danger, where wolves can come, where people can come and steal them, but they can find water and food in abundance so that their day is set well. As a shepherd of a church, if you are the pastor or you are a leader around any ministry, you are to lead your people in one direction, and that is close to the heart of the Father. That is the goal in leading, to lead their people to the heart of God. When we look at the life of Jesus, everything he said to the people was about showing them God's heart for them. He is our one clear example, the one thing that we are to follow. And yet, unfortunately, some people we know will twist scripture and make it so that they are the leader above all things, that they come first before anything else. And that is not appropriate, and it is not biblical, and is not even the way that Jesus led. He always highlighted the Father above all things. Shepherds should not be concerned with what size of Rolex they can buy. They should be concerned about the spirit of the person, about the state of their soul, about how close they are to God, about developing the kingdom of God in the hearts of those who they've been entrusted with, and seeing that non-believers come close to the Father. It takes form through vision casting, overseeing the ministries in the church, proper teaching, serving well, developing others to do the same, and having a faith that has lived close to Jesus. Anything that does not lead people to Jesus can run the risk of leading them to danger or to self. So a shepherd must be aware that the purpose of leading is carried out in a way that when we stand before God, we are without blame. Hebrews 13, verse 7, is a word for the church. Remember your leaders who spoke the word of God to you. Consider the outcome of their way of life and imitate their faith. It's encouraging, if you have a leader who has great faith, to look at that and say, what can I develop in my life that models that, that resembles that, that I can be close to Jesus just like that leader is. And then in verse 17, there's a little bit of it's a little more sobering. It's a reminder to the church of its order, but also to the leader of the responsibility both now and in eternity. It says, obey your leaders and submit to them, for they watch over your souls as those who give an account. To this end, allow them to lead with joy and not grief, for that would be of no advantage to you. Take notice, it says, they give account. We give account for every person who God entrusts us with as leaders. I'm going to use this verse's transition to the next point as well, but it's noted if you're a leader in God's kingdom, don't grasp at authority. Don't try to rule over people. Watch carefully for their souls. Because to each one, you will give account. Part of this watching, as the purpose of the shepherd, is to be one who warns the flock. Warning comes in our lives in many forms. We just heard one as the ambulance went by. That's one form of warning. Lights, sirens, something blaring, something waking you up. Earlier this week, we had multiple warnings come across our area as we had tornadoes come through. Now, I know they didn't hit our town, and actually during the tornado warning, Heidi and I went out. We had to go to Foodland, so we went and we took a picture of the beautiful sky and sent it to Michaela. But as we drove back, we headed out 7, came back across 8, looked out across the quarry there, and recognized in the distance there was a funnel cloud. Took a picture of it. We sat there and watched it rotate for about 5 minutes. You could hear it in the distance. Don't know if it was on ground. Pretty sure it wasn't. But you could see the rotation. The warnings came for us. We knew they were there. In the church, often what comes is a kind word and a gentle spirit. The first ones, the loud yelling voices, the blaring sirens, we get those warnings on social media. Anyone recognize that? You get that loud voice that says, I'm warning you now, I haven't had my coffee yet. Those are the ones that I can look at and go, I like that, I can agree with that. Give me some coffee and I'm ready for the day. But sometimes the warnings are not needed. They're things that don't need to be in place. What we need often is the kind word, the gentle spirit, because a warning is an alarm that tells you of danger. So let's say a shepherd is doing well, is leading you close to Jesus, but finds out that there's something in your life that causes danger, that can lead you astray. And so they come in a gentle spirit through the relationship and say, listen, I just need to talk to you about something because I know there's an area in your life that isn't proper. Can we just have a quick moment? I need to warn you. I need to prepare you for this. This happened in the life of David with Nathan. Prophet Nathan came after David's life, after a mistake, and told him of the error. But Nathan's will work in our lives to warn us of what is possible. As you look through the major and the minor prophets of the Old Testament, they warned Israel constantly of the life that they were approaching, of what was about to come. That is warning, that is blaring. It's a kind word, compassionate. And often they didn't listen. We need room in our lives for Nathans who can look at us and say, you need to be careful. There's something that's working in your life and it's pervasive. And it's going to come in a way that's innocuous. It doesn't seem like it's going to harm you, but it's going to lead you to danger. In 2006, there was a book that came about. And unfortunately, many in the church did not heed the warning of pastors, both personally and online and on TV, who said, don't get into the book and its teachings. It taught about things that were mystical and new age and would teach you that you didn't have to just pray, that you could believe things into like manifestation, that it wasn't even a biblical manner of believing and praying for it. It was asking the universe. Many of you are familiar with the title. It's called The Secret. Now, as a watchman, I remember a pastor standing in front of our congregation saying, stay away from it. There is danger within. I've looked it over. There is great problems. There is peril. And yet I remember churches, not just ours, but churches who had problems with members wanting to stand in front of the congregation and teach this great new theology of asking the universe for a gift. It's not proper. A warning came. When a warning comes, it's something we need to pay attention to, because it warns the flock of danger. The Bible is specific in Acts 20, Matthew 7, Philippians 3, Colossians 2, and 2 Peter 2, that shepherds are to watch out for false teachers and false prophets and warn the people to avoid them, to stay far from the practices. In this age, we see that this is easier for people to accomplish because of social media, because of YouTube, because of all of these things that they can come across your screens. False teachers, false prophets will rise up quickly. However, I don't feel, unless it is a very dangerous attack against Christianity, against an entire church, I don't feel that it's ever my responsibility to stand here, especially as we put things on YouTube, and call people out by name and say, that person needs to be avoided, run. But if I hear people who are interested, I will warn them, whether it be things like, you know, just watch out for the theology, it's difficult, it's not proper, their doctrines aren't practiced right, they do things a little strange. If it's complete heresy, if it's dangerous examples, if it's self-seeking lessons, these are things that I will talk to people because I found in personal conversation, the warnings come across better than standing in front of many and saying, watch out for so-and-so, stay away from the teaching. Interestingly, though, Paul says in verse 29 of Acts 20 that the flock will have savage wolves among them. And in verse 30, it says they'll rise up within their own number. Now, I'm not telling you this so that you look at everyone on your left and right and go, is it you? You know, ladies, don't look at your husbands and go, I always wondered about the way you make my coffee in the morning. Are you trying to lead me astray? That's not the purpose of this. The purpose is so that you understand the reason you have shepherds in your life is to trust them. Because God has given them discernment to watch for these things and to have an understanding of when warning is to come. But what I've discovered in this regard, if these things should arise, if you desire to know those who are a false teacher, it's very simple. Watch their character. Because those who are false teachers who are after it for themselves, their character shifts. It goes from very pleasing to very domineering quickly. It's often about itself. It teaches, they will talk about the things they own more than they will about the mission God has given them. These are the general ideas of false teachers because they will twist scripture and they will talk about compromise. We just got to give a little bit and do those things. Be careful. That's all it is. That's the warning. Be careful. History has done well to show us some false teachers, and you can find them online. But I remember my pastor warning of some people and others as well. The point is, the shepherd has been purposed to warn the flock when danger comes because, again, we give account for every soul that we've been trusted with. And if we just let anyone come in and grab a microphone and share whatever they want, we put the flock in danger. So that's why we're careful with how we present things and who we allow to present. Such to the point, I don't know who else has been receiving emails, but the church and my personal account have been receiving emails from a author who believes God has given him the ability to combine the doctrines of the Bible, including all of its theology, and the Quran, and make it one unified religion that God honors. He wants to come and speak to you, to which I marked spam and said, no, thank you. This is what I mean. This is the warning. This is the protection. The next one, and it is one that, let me go back. Jesus corrected the flock, his disciples, fairly often. He used words like, you have little faith. Do you not yet know? How long must I stay with you? They're introductions to an incoming correction. And if you're looking for scriptures to show this, 1st and 2nd Timothy, as well as Titus, are rich in the content of warning and correction. So number 4 is that. I don't spend much time on this. I don't remember the last time I had to correct someone. But a shepherd corrects. They warn, and then they correct when needed. Jesus did it often. Those are the examples I told you. But the reason that a shepherd corrects is to ensure a few items. First, that the false teachers do not take hold. Second, that sinful practices are privately called out and faith is restored. And 3, that unity is preserved and peace is pursued. That's the reason that a shepherd would correct. It's not something, thankfully, I said, that I have had to practice often. But it does come about, and it's never pleasurable. It's not something we seek after. If you've ever been in a place of correcting someone else, you understand that. but it's an idea that we are called to make sure that our flock is in order. James 5, 19 and 20 is a governing passage for this. It says, "My brothers and sisters, if one of you should wander from the truth and someone should bring that person back, remember this. Whoever turns a sinner from the error of their way will save them from death and cover over a multitude of sins." Again, it's the least enjoyed practice of a shepherd is to correct someone. But understanding that this can turn somebody back and bring glory to God and cover a multitude of sins should recognize in our spirits if it's necessary and we notice it as a shepherd, it's a purpose that we carry. The final purpose is to love the flock. This is what all of these things are to be done through. We teach, we care for, we warn, we love, we correct, all done through the purpose of loving one another. It is the love of Jesus that we as shepherds are to reflect. It is the love of Jesus that we as shepherds are to carry into the life of every single person. It says in Scripture that it's your kindness that leads us to repentance, and kindness comes through a form of love. And if not for love, where do you stand today? If not for the love of another looking at you, where are families? If not for the love of Jesus, where are you when it comes to relationship with God? So as a shepherd, the number one governing factor that we always look for is to do so in love. We should never look to a church and say, this coming as a pastor, we should never look and say, how can I control these people? How can I get them to do what I want? It's always to look and say, how can I love them? How can I give of myself towards them? Again, Watchman Nee in the famous statement when he said, "They've made me my leader, I'll make myself their servant." That's love. That's compassion. That's the ability to look at one and say, God has led me here in his love and I will love you in response. And so if you are a shepherd, if you're a teacher, a worship leader, whatever it is, anything you do it in love. You do it through the love of Jesus. Before you approach anything, before you pick up a microphone, before you pick up the Bible, before you stand in front of anyone, before you pick up the phone, I encourage you, pray, Jesus, help me to do this in love. Help me to serve this person, these people in love. Whatever that looks like for you, always do it in the sense of love. From love, for the sake of love, however you want to format it, do it so that people understand the love of Jesus flows through you and it registers in their hearts. As I invite the team to return, I conclude with one final thought. And that is what I believe to be a purpose that God has given pastors. How he has ordained, shepherds, how he's ordained us, how he's put us in place, what this purpose looks like. And here's what it is. As a shepherd, you are to make Jesus happy and lead people towards his holiness. So when we shared about pastors early, and the one was, you know, he's there to make me happy. We are to make Jesus happy. There are times in life where we don't get along with everyone, where we may not have people get along with us. They might not like us. We make Jesus happy and we lead people to holiness. That's the purpose that God has given the shepherd, to make him happy and to lead his people to his holiness, that they would live in righteousness, that they would experience his love, his compassion, that repentance would flow in their life. That is the purpose that we carry day in and day out. It's covered by these other things, but the number one thing that God has purposed pastors and all shepherds for, teachers, worship leaders, whatever, is to make Jesus happy and lead people close to the Father's heart and his holiness. So if you are a leader in any capacity of ministry within the church or parachurch or business, if you are a believer and you lead people, you are a shepherd in format, make Jesus happy. Lead people closer to him. Let's pray. Father, I thank you for your word. I thank you for the encouragement that you've given us, Lord, to make you happy, to lead people to holiness, to show your love to all people, that we wouldn't just be a people who stand before you and say a few words, hopefully of inspiration, but we would live out everything that we teach, that we would be worshipers, that we would be people who pursue you passionately, that we would be a great example of what it means to shepherd, because we're taking it directly from you and we are to be a good reflection of that. And Father, if any in this place feel called to lead in some format, I pray that they would first encounter you in deep, incredible ways, to know how you live and who you are and what it is that you are calling them to. And that they would then go and lead with passion, with compassion, with love, and all things to make you happy and lead people close to you. So, Lord, as we teach, care for, correct, warn, love, Father, I pray that we would do well by it as leaders, to bring people close to you, to bring the kingdom of God into all the corners of the earth. You are building your church, and you're employing us in it. Father, I pray for those who are shepherds, whatever that format looks like, that your incredible strong anointing would rest on them, that your spirit would manifest in their life day in and day out, and you would call them to a deeper relationship, even more so than they've ever experienced in their life. Father, that you would rest on them in incredible ways, that you would show them how much your love can show through them as they lead well, as they care for your people. Lord, as we worship again today, pray that you have been blessed by this and that you will be blessed by our worship and that you will speak to us. And if there's any here who have not heard their calling, Lord, let it come now so that they would know and understand where you are placing them and that it would manifest strong in their hearts, that they would shepherd well. In Jesus' name.
You know, there's a song that a few lines in it were, he's looking around and seeing the way things are in the world, the mess we've made. And he said, and I shook my fist to heaven and said, God, why don't you do something? You ever done that? And then God says, I did. I created you. Says everyone needs compassion. A love that's never failing. Everyone needs forgiveness, the kindness of a Savior. The words in the Bible says, how will they know? How will they hear if we don't tell them? And how will they know if we don't show them? Everyone needs compassion. Everyone needs compassion. A love that's never failing. Let mercy fall on me. Everyone needs forgiveness, the kindness of a Savior, the hope of nations. Savior, he can move the mountains. Our God is mighty to save. He is mighty to save forever, the author of salvation. He rose and conquered the grave. Jesus conquered the grave. Take me as you find me, all my fears and failures. And fill my life again. I give my life to follow everything I believe in. Now I surrender. Savior, he can move the mountains. Our God is mighty to save. He's so mighty to save forever. He's the author of salvation. He rose and conquered the grave. Jesus conquered the grave. Shining light and let the whole world see. We're singing for the glory of the risen King. Jesus, shining light and let the whole world see. We're singing for the glory of the risen King. Savior, he can move the mountains. Our God is mighty to save. He's so mighty to save forever. He's the author of salvation. He rose and conquered the grave. Jesus conquered the grave. Shining light and let the whole world see. We're singing for the glory of the risen King. Jesus, shining light and let the whole world see. We're singing for the glory of the risen King. Savior, he can move the mountains. My God is mighty to save. He's so mighty to save forever. Oh, he's the author of salvation. He rose and conquered the grave. Jesus conquered the grave.
It is wonderful news to know that our greatest compassion comes from God, that he directs it to us, and that through the cross, it shows the most. Something that was formed to create death actually brings us new life. As you go today, give thanks for the knowledge that you are filled with compassion that comes from God, and that it covers you. Thank you so much for joining us today, for being a part of this. It's great to see you. It's getting warm, so hopefully you have something to enjoy this afternoon before the storms come. As you make your way out, I remind you, if you want to grab a sheet or two from the trees for those supplies, it would be wonderfully helpful. Have a blessed day. We bless you as you go. Go be a blessing to others as well.